Matter of Fact Montreal with Mitch Gallo, Kim Summers, Jacob Sarabrin, Charlene Lusikila. The show that gets you the facts that matter about the city you love. With editorialist Alex Terp, sports reporter Toby Elliott, and your hosts, Michael Connors and Jennifer Freitas. Your news team, your city. Matter of Fact.
Coming up on today's show.
Green Ave is losing a signature tenant. What does this mean for the community?
The cross is back in style, but is it just the symbolism that's back, or is God really taking center stage in the lives of young Quebecers?
And we go deep with the Owls, talking about the playoffs. So if you like football, or if you're into sweaty men, tag along, but try and control yourselves.
Hi, I'm Mike Connors.
And I'm Jennifer Freitas. Welcome to the Matter of Fact.
And welcome to Olympic Stadium, a Montreal landmark, whether you like it or not. This show, we will be looking at the site, but before that, we're going to concentrate on another Montreal landmark. It will be the end of an era. Saint-Saison is closing its doors forever. And what does this mean for the employees and people who like to visit the grocer? Mitch Gallo went there to eat one last time.
Welcome to Green Avenue in Westmount. The street features many boutiques and shops along its strip. On the corner of the Maisonneuve and Green is Saint-Saison Grocery. But after 25 years at the location, the grocery will close on December the 5th. The store's employees have all been given jobs at various metros around the city, but where will Saint-Saison's regular clients now shop for groceries?
Obviously, there are a lot of stores you can go and shop for whatever you want, but at the same time, to find a store like this one is not very easy to find.
A bit of a learning curve, maybe, walking all the way to the metro at the mall. I think we'll adapt.
Because I know a lot of people like to meet here outside in the summer, so I think it's too bad.
The grocery's regulars won't be the only ones affected. Many business owners, like the owner of Tony Shoes, Tony Farnoli, rely on the grocery to generate traffic on the strip. Even after 35 years as the manager and more than 60 years at that location, he's still worried business Good. Will suffer.
So what sort of happens is that you find that people meet there. They not only shop there, it's a social event, okay? And so what we're concerned about, I think many of the merchants on the street, is that this social happening is going to be lost.
Now, the problem here wasn't even economical. Actually, Saint-Saison was pulling in enough money to support itself. For the last 18 years, they've been renting the land. And now, the owner wants to put condominiums in instead of Saint-Saison. So if I want fresh deli or a nice sandwich like this one, I can always head to the Saint-Saison in Outremont. For the matter of fact, I'm Mitch Gallo.
I recently visited the Nazareth House, which is a homeless shelter for men looking for guidance on how to live an independent lifestyle.
So, what's going on there?
Well, between the death of the founder and a 20% drop in private donations, Nazareth House is operating $50,000 in the red and almost closed the doors last spring. But since the Catholic Community Services stepped in and advanced the funds, they also are providing administrative services for a minimal fee. Now, this is not only a story about the Nazareth House, it's also about their new lease on life. But more importantly, it's about the men who can continue to benefit from its services. Here's their story. It's been a long 20 men benefit from Nazareth House. Robert Cuddle is one of them. He's the most outspoken of the group, and he wasn't afraid to tell us his story.
I've been at the Douglas Hospital for over, off and on, for over 35 years. They tried to treat me for bipolar illness, manic depressive illness.
But this reality didn't stop him from painting happy moments.
I've never once drawn anything negative that I suffered in my life, although I suffer more than most people in the world.
However, he has a hard time selling his paintings.
What sells is abstract garbage. All the galleries you see is abstract garbage.
Leandro Tolentino is the director of Nazareth House. He's working on ways to help men like Robert overcome their difficulties.
I would seek funding, particularly for programs and projects that will deliver more the enhancement of mental health.
Leandro auctioned off many of Robert's paintings at last weekend's fundraiser.
Thank you.
Robert sold 5 paintings, and he's feeling great about it.
Well, I owed $400 of credit cards, and I can pay off a credit card bill.
Among his brothers at the mission, Robert's leading the way in building a life for himself outside of Nazareth House. For the matter of fact, I'm Jennifer Freitas in Côte d'Elias.
Did you know that Pope John Paul II came here in 1984? He spoke in front of 50,000 Quebec youth. 7,000 kids had sent him letters in the Vatican. Do you think kids these days hold Christianity in the same light?
Well, you'll be surprised by the answer. I mean, think of all the crucifixes and rosaries and gold, silver, and covered in diamonds that we see dangling from people's necks and wrapped around their wrists. The cross has definitely made a comeback, and our reporter, Charlene Sikila, followed one young woman for whom the cross is more than a pendant.
It's Friday night, and it's heating up on St. Lawrence Street. After a week filled with midterms work, young people are ready to let loose and have fun. South of the island, things are also moving in front of Nouvelle Vie Church. Youth coming from all parts of Montreal and the South Shore are getting ready to celebrate. Ready to celebrate God. Nouvelle Vie is Quebec's largest Protestant evangelical church. Located in Longueuil, the church welcomes around 3,000 people per week, and more than 400 youth between the ages of 12 and 35 attend the Friday youth group known as Impact Jeunesse. 18-year-old Michel Descaries is one of them. Originally from Sherbrooke, Michel has been attending Impact Jeunesse for a year now. Contrary to most of Quebec's youth, God takes center stage in her life. However, it has not always been easy for her to fully live her faith, as the world she evolved in rejected everything she believed in. But as she grows older, she gains confidence in her Christian identity.
Gain the maturity in my spiritual life as well as my personal life. And those things are not as important to me. Like, I know I have God. God is always with me. So I don't really care what other people think. What cares is what God thinks of me.
As many young adults her age, Nichelle faces several challenges.
Not perfect.
She says her faith is what keeps her grounded.
And things every day. I have school, I have stress, I have work, I have my friends. There's always going to be something, but believing in God always reassures me that there's always a way through.
Numbers show that youth attendance in churches keeps on decreasing with the years, and more teenagers define themselves as atheists. In a province where the church is often criticized, does Michelle ever question her faith?
He has the right to question his belief system. And when I was a little younger, I went through a rough period in my life where I did question my faith.
Michelle had been dating a guy who did not share her belief in God, and this caused tensions in their relationship.
And I really questioned myself, is it worth really believing and giving?
But she soon realized that her life without God did not really make sense.
I didn't know what to do. I wasn't happy. I was always missing something in my life. That's when I realized that my life is complete with Him.
She believes other young adults may also be looking for God in their lives, but she thinks they often mistake God with the Catholic Church, and this just draws them even further from religion. Sociologist of religions, Ilana Georgiou, thinks that the Catholic Church may be losing young adherents because it is not adjusting to today's generation.
Young people are raising questions in certain terms, but the religious instance doesn't give their answers in the same terms.
Impact Jeunesse pastor David Petit knows this and seeks to meet this need.
C'est certain que les messages sont conçus de façon à parler de thèmes qui sont des réalités que les jeunes vivent. On parle, oui, de vie spirituelle, mais aussi de vie spirituelle en relation avec des réalités de la vie comme la sexualité, grande question éthique, l'avortement, ces choses.
And Michelle hopes this will keep on attracting people.
Happiness to my heart to see people my age that really do believe in God.
For the matter of fact, I'm Charlene Sikila in Longueuil.
Coming up,
some students have loans. How can they pay them off?
The Freitas Fashion Minute
and Mike's procrastination story.
Hey, Jen, do you ever lose things?
What kind of things?
Oh, you know, keys, bags, cats, banjos.
No, not all of those things.
Well, if you did, where would you look if you wanted to find them?
I would look in the lost and found.
Okay, but what if you're outside?
Then I don't know.
Well, our reporter Jacob Sarabin found a place on the internet that you can connect with your lost goods.
When Max Kelly lost his banjo, the first place he turned was Craigslist.
A day passed, it was Sunday night, you know, about 24 hours since when I left it, after I had done all the advertising, and I got an email of a kind person living in the McGill ghetto who found it that night and saw my ad on Craigslist.
Now, this isn't the first time you've lost a banjo.
I had a really cheap banjo a few years ago, the first one I owned, and I didn't care much for it, and I had left it very close to my house in a very similar circumstance. I went on the internet and advertised its loss, and it wasn't there. I never got it back. But with that circumstance, I didn't go on Craigslist for a few days. Whereas just with the second incident, I went on right away.
Do you think because you acted so quickly that was what made the difference?
Well, I think it's just getting more popular. It was only a passing thought the first time to put it in Craigslist, whereas with this time, it was the first thing I thought of and first thing my friends told me to do.
The Lost and Found section of the Montreal Craigslist page gets about 4 or 5 new posts every day, ranging from things like memory cards for digital cameras to pets and even one person looking for their long-lost relatives. For the matter of fact, I'm Jacob Sarabin.
It took 30 years to pay off the Big O. Imagine the interest on that.
I'm pretty sure some graduates know what that feels like. It's hard enough finding a job. Imagine paying off a student loan. Our reporter, Kim Summers, looks into strategies on how to pay off debt.
Enrollment has gone up in universities across the country, and it's not because post-secondary education has suddenly become more affordable. Neither are students richer. In fact, a majority of students now turn to financial aid for support. In Quebec, statistics reveal that 60% of students rely on the provincial loan and bursary program. For the undergraduate level alone, it climbs to almost 80%. Marie Nguyen is one of those students. She's now in her third year in architecture at the University of Montreal. And so far, she received $7,000 in loans to pay for tuition and craft supplies. Marie admits that borrowing money isn't an easy situation.
So it worries me because I don't work a lot aside from school, so.
She hopes to pay back her loan as fast as possible.
My strategy would be working as many hours as I can, going out of school and to pay all my debts.
But is it really the best tactic? Meet Geneviève Gélinot-Roy, a financial advisor at Carrefour Desjardins. Gélinot-Roy advises students to find the strategy that suits them best, but 4 key points can apply to everyone.
The student loan from the government is the last loan that you pay.
Also, make sure to start looking for a job early, even before you graduate. Start paying off your debt as soon as possible and always have a safety cushion, which amounts to 3 months of all your expenses. And what if Marie doesn't find a job in Montreal? She says she'll have to move out of town. For a matter of fact, I'm Kim Summers at the University of Montreal.
The only thing towering over the 1976 Olympics were a couple of cranes and a big oops. Strikes, disorganization, and French architect Roger Taillebert's audacious design turned the Big O into the Big Ow. The whole fiasco is now used by the IOC as the example of what not to do if hosting the Olympics. In 1987, the tower was completed, but the plans had to be modified because the tower they called for was too heavy, and if completed, would have brought the whole stadium crashing down. The original roof struggled to function and finally ripped. It was replaced and ripped again. The Montreal Expos played their last game in 2004, and now the stadium hosts little more than 10 events a year. It cost an estimated $1.5 billion, making it one of the most expensive structures of its kind in the world. What's a BA worth? A recent study by the Globe and Mail says it. Employers want a master's degree.
But is a master's really all that necessary? Our editorialist, Alex Turk, gets down to the facts.
What can my BA get me? Will I have a job? A decent salary? Do I absolutely need an MBA to get any of those things? It seems as though a lot of university students are asking themselves these very questions in recent years. And you can't blame them for feeling lightheaded or confused. It's not as if the job market is ever consistent in its demands. The truth is, there are no easy answers. Not when an MBA is a must in certain areas and overqualification in others. The situation's not really anybody's fault. One could call it the result of competitive graduating students trying to one-up each other. But be that as it may, universities are going to have to start looking at the costs and the structure of their undergraduate programs if this keeps up. It's not that they've done anything wrong. It's that they, like everybody else, need to adapt. But will this academic inflation ever end? Some students might take comfort in the prospect that baby boomers are set to retire by the thousands in coming years, potentially opening up countless jobs. Let's hope for their sake that it happens. And let's hope that it makes the job market a bit less difficult to deal with. Because as it stands, students can't be faulted for wondering not only whether their BA is worth anything, but also whether it's worth the good money that they're paying for it. For matter of fact, I'm Alexandre Turp.
The Swedish junior national team at the Concordia.
We're here actually is because we want to, recognize the style of the play, because when we meet Canada, we're going to meet this type of hockey.
If this was a learning experience, consider Concordia school. Kalinberg opened it up, and before you knew it, it was 2-0. The Swedes drove the puck down ice relentlessly for a total of 66 shots on net. The Stingers, meanwhile, seemed to prefer it in the penalty box. Final score, 8-2, Sweden getting 5 goals on the power play.
So Mike, tell me, what's going on at the Olympic Stadium?
CFL playoffs are coming up, and Montreal fans must be ecstatic after the great season the Alouettes have had. The Eastern Final is just around the corner, and our reporter Toby Elliott went the length of the field to bring you the facts on what it takes for the Alouettes to stay focused.
The players seemed loose, relaxed as they practiced, going over plays, doing some stretching, and generally joking around. They can afford to be relaxed, though. After all, they were going up against the lowest-ranked team in the Eastern Division, the Toronto Argonauts. On the other hand, the Owls have been camped out in first place for weeks now, and their berth in the playoff finals was a sure thing. But when asked if the upcoming game still mattered, the men on the field say it still counts.
It means a lot to us, and there's a lot on the line for us as far as pride and professionalism and momentum going into the playoffs.
That's what everyone played this game for, to try to win the championship. You know, just the team chemistry that we have and the type of guys we have in our locker room that stays on one another.
Some say the Owls have never looked better, crediting it to coach Mark Tressman. But he says their strong showing this season is due to just one thing.
Well, I think they're self-motivated. I don't do anything.
You don't?
Nope. I think they're guys who love football, they're high character, and they do it all.
As it turned out, the Owls trounced Toronto 42-17 for their club record 15th win of the regular season. Their perfect 9-0 at-home record was last matched in 1997 by the Argonauts.
So there you have it. It's teamwork and the love of the game that keeps these tough birds on top. And perhaps this year it'll bring home a Grey Cup, too. For the matter of fact, at the Olympic Stadium in Montreal, I'm Toby Elliott.
So Jen, now tell me, it's what every guy really wants to know, what's going on in fashion?
Mike, I knew you were going to ask me that question. Have a look at my Frida's Fashion Minute.
Get your fix of Jimmy Choo. The newest collection hits H&M stores tomorrow. If you're eyeing a new Jimmy Choo bag, or a pair of pumps, or even some star-studded jewelry, make sure to be among the 160 people in line. It'll give you access to these great goodies. This Sunday is the Au Coeur de la Mode fundraising event, being held at the Palais de Congrès. You'll have access to discounted designer clothing and accessories, and all proceeds will go to the Fair AIDS Foundation.
Also going on this weekend, the Rocketeers are in town for Radio City's Christmas Spectacular on Friday and Saturday at the Bell Centre. I'm Mike Connors.
Wait, what happened to your procrastination piece, Mike?
And we'll see you next week.
I'm Jennifer Freitas. Thanks for tuning in.
Who's Ben Cahoon? All right. Okay.
Well, the CFL playoffs are coming up, and I'm kind of looked at you and then at the camera. So we're gonna go right away off the top again. Reporter Telly Bobiet went the length of the arena to bring you the hockey.
All right.
Okay, all right, let's go.
For men looking for guidance on how to live an independent lifestyle.
So what's going on there?
I recently visited the Nazareth House, a homeless shelter for men looking for guidance on how to live an independent lifestyle.
Sorry.
That wasn't funny.
I know. Okay, let's go again. I have no idea, okay?
Now, the story is about the Nazareth House. No, it's a tongue twister. Now, this story is about the Catholic... Fucking... I put too much energy, I find.
Energy's good. Okay. Welcome to Olympic Stadium, a Montreal landmark, whether you like it or not.
I think I'm too high for him. My voice...
The dog. Yeah.
Oh my god, if I fall
down. Oh wait, I didn't realize. Okay. Woo. So when the wind goes, it goes, right?
Every guy wants to know. Okay, ready? Okay. November 22nd, here at Olympic Stadium. One more time.
You don't pronounce it though.
Yeah, I know.
Development and Peace were at St. Kevin's Parish this past Sunday. They were asking church attendees to sign petition cards to raise awareness about supporting small-scale farms. These cards are addressed to Prime Minister Stephen Harper. Here's what the organization is asking of him.
To put pressure on the G8 leaders to favor the small farmer producers instead of favoring the big agro-business companies so that food can be grown for people instead of for cars.
The next G8 conference will be held in Huntsville, Ontario next spring.
However,